Have you ever heard someone use the term watershed moment to describe an important or historical event? Usually, a watershed moment refers to a lot of small things leading up to one big event or impact. For example, my high school graduation was a watershed moment for me. All of the classes I took, the assignments I completed, the clubs I participated in, all of these seemingly little things led up to a single big watershed moment, earning my diploma. In environmental science, this word means the same thing, but we aren't talking about an achievement. We're actually talking about water. So if a watershed moment is one where small events lead to a big one, what do you think the definition of a watershed might mean in environmental science? Pause the video here to record your thoughts. A watershed is the area of land from which all water, including surface and groundwater, drains into a central location. All of these smaller sources of fresh water drain into a big water resource. You can think of this like a big funnel, directing water from a larger area into one central location. In this lesson, you'll learn all about the watersheds that we depend on for freshwater resources and why protecting these watersheds is so important. Are you ready, scientists? Let's dive in. Welcome to the Colorado River. This watershed is an important freshwater source for 40 million people in the US and Mexico. At any given moment, there are about 17 trillion gallons of water in the Colorado River. But where does all of that water come from? When rain falls on the ground, it becomes runoff, flowing downhill until it joins a stream or a small river called a tributary. These streams and tributaries eventually flow into a big watershed, like the Colorado River. In fact, the Russian Colorado River is actually fed by tributaries that carry water from parts of 7 different states. There are a variety of factors that impact the flow of water in watersheds. Understanding these factors can help us accurately predict the flow of fresh water, helping us manage this precious, limited resource. Take a look at this diagram. If rain were to fall at location A, where do you think it would fall? What about location B and location C? Pause the video here to record your predictions. You might have predicted that the water at location A would flow down the hill. The slope of the land is a big factor that impacts how water moves in a watershed. The steeper the slope of the land, the faster the water flows down it. You can see this when water slowly trickles over a flat area, but roars and rushes down a steep waterfall. We can use maps of a land area to see the topography, the higher and lower elevations. Using these maps, we can track how water follows the land to deposit into different watersheds. We can also use these maps to identify upstream and downstream locations and predict how pollution might travel across the watershed. Vegetation can also impact the speed of water flow in a watershed. Grasses, trees, and other plants soak up some of this surface water, so the more plants in the area, the slower the flow, and the better the filtration of the water as it moves in the watershed. We can clearly see how surface freshwater flows into the Colorado River. But there's another source of fresh water feeding this watershed, even if we can't see it. Think about the other sources of fresh water on Earth. What other type of water might be feeding this watershed? Groundwater. Groundwater is simply water stored underground in aquifers. An aquifer is a layer of rock or sediment that water can pass through, creating a pool of underground freshwater. Soil permeability determines how much water from the surface moves underground. To permeate means to pass through. So soil with high permeability has a lot of space for water to pass through. Dense, compacted soils are less permeable. There's less space for water to move underground. If water is stored in tight underground material like solid rock, it becomes confined or trapped in one place. However, if the underground material is composed of sand, loose soil, or rocks with holes, the water can move freely through the empty spaces. These are called unconfined aquifers. Okay, so the type of rock affects aquifers. But there's another factor as well. Space. What do you think happens when underground aquifers take in more water than they have room for? Pause the video here and record your predictions. As the permeable soil becomes saturated or filled with water, the water level rises until there's no more space to hold it underground. This water eventually emerges as surface water in the watershed. You can see this during a really rainy season when the grass becomes swampy and flooded once the soil beneath it can't hold any more water. Groundwater is slower at feeding watersheds than surface water, but it's essential to keeping rivers like the Colorado flowing year-round. Both surface water and groundwater are essential in keeping the Colorado River watershed flowing and supplied with enough water. Surface water is often the most accessible source of fresh water, but drilling wells into aquifers is an important water source too, especially during droughts. We need to understand how both surface water and groundwater move as we access and share this essential resource. Watersheds aren't just interesting to study. They are essential to life. Healthy watersheds are the reason we have clean, reliable sources of fresh water. When both surface water and groundwater are working together, watersheds can supply water for drinking, farming, wildlife, and recreation. They also filter pollutants, reduce the risk of flooding, and help keep ecosystems balanced. Factors like slope, vegetation, and soil permeability all affect the flow of water. However, there's still another variable that can affect these factors: human activity. Take paved surfaces, for instance. Water can't pass underground through paved areas, so instead of being soaked up by permeable soil, it runs off as surface water. Dams and reservoirs can block the normal flow of smaller tributaries into big watersheds, and natural land areas that are converted to agricultural fields or residential areas can change the slope of the land or the amount of vegetation in a watershed area. As you can see, there are a lot of factors to consider. With this in mind, which tool do you think is the most helpful to keep track of them all? If you guessed maps, you're spot on. Maps help us see how aquifers and rivers interact across landscapes, but they also help us understand how vulnerable these systems are. You'll practice using watershed maps in your lesson activities. Without healthy watersheds, entire communities, farms, and ecosystems can face serious water shortages. But watersheds are vulnerable, and water is a limited resource. Changing one part of a watershed can throw off the entire system, setting off a chain reaction that impacts the fresh water supply of people miles and miles away. That's why protecting watersheds matters. By carefully managing our water use and the land that affects it, we can get the most out of this valuable resource. As we went through the lesson today, we learned all about watersheds, where lots of small freshwater sources feed into one big water resource, like the Colorado River. Watersheds collect and move water, and both surface water and groundwater feed the system. Humans depend on this water every day, and in the next lesson, we'll learn more about how we can make sustainable choices to protect our limited freshwater resources. Remember, watersheds are not endless sources of water. They are complex, delicate systems that must be protected if we want clean, dependable water now and in the future. Until next time, remember, every drop of water is a part of a bigger system. Learning about each part of a watershed can help us protect water for everyone who depends on it. Stay observant, keep asking questions, and I'll see you next time. Hey.